can access all the materials. I'm adding them to the Auto system. So these materials are available, and also you have access to all the previous year's materials as well, as I have previously mentioned. So let us continue. So far we have talked about analog signal modulation, and well, you have seen that it is possible to use some mathematics to actually calculate the expected spectrum. For digital modulated signals, the same approach can be used as well. So now what I'd like to first mention is that actually we are not going to talk today about demodulating process. So far we have talked about only how to perform modulation, yes, but there is also a reverse process when you have this blue signal received and you need to read the information from it, yes, extract out this message signal. So this is the topic for another lecture, and mostly we'll talk about digital demodulation, but still I'd like to mention that today you are actually going to get your first experience with this demodulation process, when you will actually extract information out in your practical exercise too. So don't be alarmed if you didn't completely understand that idea yet. It will be all explained to you in the future lectures, but just know that today actually we are going to try and receive such demodulated signal. So, but this will be on our third lecture today. Now we are going to talk about some modulating process. Naturally, before you can demodulate signal, you need to accordingly make this modulation. Now, and the difference between digital and analog modulated signals is actually very small. And it's this basic difference is that you convert your message signal from continuous into discrete or analog or digital signal. Yes, and so basically that is all the difference, that now your message signal is digital, for example. Yes, and the carrier is still analog signal, and the modulated signal will also still be analog signal. The only thing is that now, if previously our amplitude was changing, for example, amplitude or frequency or phase, doesn't really matter, yes, was changing gradually and slowly, yes, for example, here you can see that amplitude is different at each point of this signal. Then for digital signals, there will be only some levels. Yes, for example, like this. And amplitude will, or amplitude or frequency or phase, yes, any parameter of carrier signal will change with these discrete steps. Yes, so basically it can be either 0 or 1, nothing in between. Yes, and it also doesn't change so often, yes, so there is some time where this parameter is constant. So this is called manipulation, yes, or rather in terms of what we'll discuss in our course project, shift keying, yes. So shift keying. So this way, this is the only difference, yes, that the message signal is now divided into some samples, and in between these samples, the previous state of the modulator is preserved. So this way, basically, it's happening. So we can, accordingly, very similar way, describe three cases. 1, amplitude shift keying, 2 of them are angular in a very similar way. And we are discussing currently only binary amplitude shift keying, binary frequency shift keying, binary phase shift keying. What does this really mean? This means that for amplitude shift keying, you are going to have two amplitude values only, corresponding to 0 and corresponding to 1. For the frequency shift keying, you are going to have two different frequencies, F0 and F1. And for the phase shift keying, you are going to have two phase values, yes, phi 0 and phi 1. So each of these logical signals 1 and 0 has its own signal, yes, carrier signal, which is then put or added or introduced into our carrier in the same way as we have studied it right here. Yes, so we are not going to get into too much detail how these signals are generated right now, because as I have mentioned, we'll have separate lectures for this purpose. Just going to remind you that now we have like samples. Yes, for example, here is our first sample, here is our second sample, third sample, fourth sample, and so on. And in between these samples, the value of the last sample is maintained. So basically, up to this moment, this sample was basically the same, yes, not changing. And therefore, this amplitude of the carrier also changes in between two values. Yes, our amplitude can be either 1 or 0. Yes, so here it's not like simple zero line, it's actually 0 multiplied with sin omega 0 t. Yes, so amplitude multiplied by some function. Yes, however, zero multiplied by any number or any function produces 0, as you know. So basically this looks like a constant level. However, mathematically speaking, this is actually the modulated signal. Yes, so message multiplied with the carrier. Similarly, it happens here. Message multiplied with carrier. Message is 1, so we have clear carrier here. Yes. So this is for amplitude shift keying. For binary frequency shift keying, it's intentionally marked in different colors for 1 and 0 in all these cases, so that it's easier to see where is 1 and where is 0. We have now similar process. Now, if previously for frequency modulated signal you have observed that this frequency has been increasing slowly, yes, and continuously, and again, therefore, after reaching some point, it was decreasing also slowly and continuously without, jumps and large steps. And then in this particular case, now this frequency can be only either 1 value or 2 values. Yes, so or either 1 of 2 possible values. So the change is now happening momentarily. Yes, there is no longer a slow transitioning between these two frequencies. So here we have one frequency, here we have another frequency. And this is the main difference of digital modulated signals. Yes, that basically everything happens in the very same way. However, now there is some discrete step. Yes, all these changes are also accordingly happening in a single moment rather than slowly. And for the phase shift keying, actually, this is very similar. Yes, we have one initial phase here, which is 0, and we have initial phase of P here. So basically, here the first signal is sin omega 0 t, and the second signal, I'm going to use green here, is sin omega 0 t plus p, which is, as you know from trigonometrics, minus sin omega 0 t. And therefore, you can actually see that this sign starts from going negative, yes? And this starts going positive. So this way, it's actually working. And here you can see the change of the phase, which also is happening momentarily. Now, this is a brief introduction to how binary, or maybe not exactly only binary, we can have multiple phase levels or multiple amplitude levels. For example, we can have amplitude of 1, we can have amplitude of 2, and have amplitude of 3, of 0, and so forth. And well, in this case, well, actually, I can show you, we have some time in octave how to this signal would look like. So consider we have some data message signal, message, consisting of digits 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, again 3, again 2, again 1, again 5, 4, and so on. Yes, so this is our message signal. Now we are going to use some modulation. So I'm going to make some carrier signal, which would be, for example, sin p multiplied by 1 from 0 to, well, let us say 99 divided by 20. I'm going to see how it looks like. Is it okay? Yes, so this is the carrier signal. It looks fine. And now I'm going to make some modulated signal by using Kronecker multiplication, which you already know from your first practical exercise. So Kronecker multiplication, speaking simply, just takes each of these numbers, for example, 0, and replaces it with this entire signal multiplied by this 0. So 0 multiplied with this signal is put inside of this 0. Inside of this 1, we put accordingly the signal multiplied by 1. And inside of 2, we put signal multiplied by 2, and so forth and so on. So now I'm making this Kronecker multiplication between message signal, carrier signal, and plotting this modulated signal this way. Now you can see that this amplitude is again changing with some specific steps. So here we have one step, another step, and so forth. Yes, so this is not a binary modulation, yes, but the idea still is the same, yes, and step can be different depending on what is data. So data is here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 3, 2, 1, 5, 4. Yes, I believe 0. So this is not necessarily only binary modulation. Yes, we can use as many amplitude levels or phase levels or frequencies as we need to. Yes, however, binary is the most simple. Yes, and also, as it turns out, the most effective in spectrum and noise immunity. Yes, because, well, when you have signal which we can, for example, take values of 0, 1, 2, or 3, the error can be much more worse. Yes, because you can, for example, send 0 and get either 1, either 2, either 3, or 0. Anything can be received instead of 0 because of the error. Yes. Now, when you send, when you operate only with ones and zeros, this is the most noise immune case because you can get either 0 or 1. And the difference between them is also much greater than between these. For example, here we in voltage, for example, we can have 5 volts per all of these levels. And you already looked into signal to noise ratio, yes, in the previous practical exercise. And here we also have 5 volts. So here we have 5 volts between two levels. And here we have, well, 5 volts divided by 3, which is around 1 volt and half, yes, somewhere around this between these two levels, which is much less, yes, and accordingly the noise needs to be much lower in order to make an error here. So binary is more effective this way. And also it's simpler, yes, and considering that we'll need to perform some simulations, it's also will be easier for you to make binary keys. So, okay, so we now have described some harmonic modulated signals. What about pulsed signals? How can we use them? So, as a carrier, in this case, we are using some rectangular pulses with short duration, yes, very short rectangular pulses. So we can have pulse amplitude modulation, we can have pulse width modulation, we can have pulse position modulation. So basically, these are parameters for our pulse. We can have rectangular form pulse and it has amplitude. Yes, it can have position, so it's currently located here, but it could have as well been somewhere around here, for example. And it also has some width, which can also be changed. You can have this pulse, or you can have this pulse, or you can have even this pulse. Yes. So basically, this is the idea. So these three cases are somewhat similar to binary amplitude shift keying, binary frequency shift keying, and binary phase shift keying. Somewhat are like equivalents of those modulation types. Now, pulse coded modulation is entirely different story. It's basically converting analog signal into digital signal. So basically this ADC conversion, mostly, yes, we are talking about. And well, let's take a closer look to each of these cases. So what is similar to all these cases and accordingly different to harmonic signals is that we use them for baseband signal processing. So there is no frequency translation. Yes, we don't move the spectrum from one frequency to another frequency, unlike for continuous waves. So therefore, all these signals can be sent into cables, into optical fiber, and not radio. Yes, not radio send transmissions. And this is all needed for different microcontrollers. Yes. Even for regulating the brightness of the light, as you will see from example. And this is how it works. So let us talk first about pulse amplitude modulation. So basically, we have carrier signal as this sequence of rectangular pulses, yes, and the amplitude of these rectangular pulses is specified by this message signal. So this is message signal. Now we multiply this message signal with a carrier, very similar way as before, yes, so we have message and we have carrier. And as a result, we get a modulated signal. So the approach is very same, yes, and as you can see, we have these pulses taking the amplitude of the message signal. Now, there can be two different cases. We can have natural pulse amplitude modulation, which is shown here. As you can see, the amplitude of the rectangular pulse actually repeats in shape the fragment of the message signal. Yes, here we have this fragment, here we have this fragment, and so forth and so on. Or we can have flat top pulse amplitude modulation. In that case, these pulses will still be rectangular because these pulses are no longer rectangular pulses, yes, but we can also make some averaging, yes, and make them again in rectangular shape. You can read more about these in this link, yes, which already was shown to you previously. Yes. Now we are talking about these pulse amplitude modulation signals. Yes, you can see here for the natural palm, it's shown in the same picture with the original signal, and you can clearly see that the rectangular shape of the pulse has been changed to match the form of the data signal. So this is called natural, and this is actually flat top. Yes, when we have, well, preserved the rectangular shape of the pulse at the cost of maybe not so precise signal, because once we try to connect with line all these pulses, we can see that we need to do some approximation rather than simple line connecting like here. So basically, this is the same picture in larger scale, yes, which shows how flat top pulse amplitude modulation is different from natural impulse modulation. So next step is not step, but the type is pulse width modulation. So basically, yes, PVM, these modulation types. Now in this case, we are no longer taking into consideration the amplitude, but the duration of the impulse. Yes, so we have rectangular pulses of different durations. Well, and the higher is the amplitude, the shorter impulse we have. Yes, so here you can see that these pulses are actually also polarity of the pulse depends on whether our signal is increasing or is it decreasing. Yes. So yes, the idea why we need to use this is basically most often related to providing some level of the constant voltage of the DC component. Yes, so imagine you have, for example, this sequence of pulses. We can calculate the average level, which would be accordingly somewhere around here. Next case, when we have these pulses, these pulses. So the average DC component level will be higher, somewhere like this. Or again, we can have much shorter pulses, which are coming with the equal frequency, yes. And therefore, the average DC component level will be lower. So this way, actually, if you have a diode light tape, yes, so light tape, some tape, yes, with some light diodes, for example, in the kitchen to make lightning, yes, you can actually have controller regulating the brightness of this LED strip, yes, light emitting diode strip. So, and this controller will produce accordingly different duration rectangular pulses, which will then give you different DC components. So therefore, with your controller, you are changing the duration of each pulse. So the higher is the duration, the brighter will be this LED strip, and vice versa. Yes, so this way we can control also DC motors, yes, and perform similar tasks. So basically, that is where we are using these pulse width modulated signals. We don't use this modulation type for transmitting any information which is needed for you to read it or do something with it, with that. Well, except for the case when maybe this information is related to the brightness of the LED diode or to the rotation speed of this motor or something like that. Yes, it's more like a specific type of information we are dealing with in this particular case. Yes, so here we can see also some information about how these pulse amplitude modulates are generated, much more information actually, how it can be demodulated, so forth and so forth. So basically this article is more focused on pulse amplitude modulation, yes. And for the pulse width modulation and position modulation, well, they're basically used in some technical devices mostly. Yes? Now, for the pulse code modulation, basically what we are talking about here is analog to digital converter. So basically, analog to digital converter is the modulator which is performing this pulse coded modulation. And well, we already have discussed and mentioned it in previous lectures. Yes, the input is analog signal. Here we have continuous time, continuous amplitude signal, so some sort of this. Now here we have two steps. First step is to read the discrete signal values from this analog signal, which is still voltage levels and not really rounded off in any way. And the next step is perform a digital quanting, yes, of the signal by limiting amplitude to some specific steps. So this way here we have basically digital signal, yes. And this digital signal is then converted into digital binary code words. Yes, so the output is binary signal. Again, here you can see more information, yes, which is, well, additional reading if you are interested to read more. Yes, here, by the way, no, it's not really that. So some pictures about quantization. We will also mention it right now, types of PCM and so forth, so more. Yeah, so basically time sampling is reading samples from our analog signal with some specific time interval, which we already have shown that this needs to be selected carefully because of this maximum frequency in our spectrum. Yes, so that no aliasing can occur. And because if this aliasing will occur, it will be impossible to reconstruct the signal from these initial points. Yes, so this is sampling, time sampling. Next step is quantization. Yes, and accordingly, this puts each sampled value closer to one or another level. So assigns them to levels, and each level then has a binary code word assigned to it, yes. And therefore we convert this voltage, yes, so here we have voltage, for example, 5 volts and minus 5 volts, into the binary code words, yes. And then as a result we get these signals, yes. So the quantizing. Let us talk a little bit about quantizing. The quantizing can be uniform and non-uniform. Here you can see the uniform quantizing. Each step is equal. Yes, there are no like smaller steps or bigger steps. So basically each step is equal, and we divide all our interval of, for example, 10 volts in total in this case. If this was 5 volts, this was minus 5 volts. So the total difference was 10 volts, and we divide this 10 volts into uniformly separated steps. Yes, and each level is then assigned a code word. Now for the non-uniform, it is different. Yes, we have smaller steps at the lower voltage levels. Here you can see the smaller steps, and we have larger steps at the higher voltage levels. So this is non-uniform. And again, here is an additional information for you to study on if you are interested. Yes, about this quantization, some nice picture too. Why we may need this non-uniform quantization? Basically, we need this non-uniform quantization in cases when our signal can be very strong and very weak. So consider comparison between these uniform and non-uniform quantization in this picture. So we have two signals. Blue signal is strong signal and red signal is weak signal. Now, each of them originally was analog signal. So yes, here you can see this analog signal. And another analog signal, I won't mark it. It can be clearly seen here. So what happens if we are having uniform quantization? So here we have 16 levels, yes, which is 4 bits per level. So each of these levels will have 4 binary digits assigned to them. And well, considering that here we have maximum voltage, here we have minimum voltage, we divide this interval uniformly into some small steps, yes, and therefore we need to accordingly quantize this weak signal according to these steps. So what happens here? Here we can see that all the values that are not on these levels are rounded to closest level. So basically in this case, this point is rounded here, this point is rounded here, this point is rounded here, here, and so forth. Here we start rounding to this level. Here still to this level, yes, and so forth. And basically, initially we had harmonic signals, sine wave. Now you can see that after this conversion, basically we have binary signal which has rectangular shape. Now, of course, we can restore somewhat this shape, but at any rate, the accuracy how we describe this weak signal is by no means close to accuracy of the strong signal. You can see that the strong signal is described much more accurately, yes, with these steps. And weak signal, well, not so accurately at all for uniform. Now, for non-uniform quantizing, we have a little bit different approach, yes? So here we have zero level, yes? And now at close to the zero level, we have smaller step than this, yes? So clearly this step is much smaller than this. And at the end, we also have larger step than here. However, this larger step in no way makes this more or like less accurate, yes? It's still very accurately described signal. Now, this small difference, however, now allows us to show the signal much more similar to sine wave rather than it was before. Yes, this is more accurately. Of course, you may say that we actually could have taken not 16 levels, but 256 levels, yes? And this way, it would be possible indeed to describe this weak signal much better. But again, even so, we can still use non-uniform quantizer with 256, and then we'll actually get something very similar to a real sine wave, even at these weak levels. Yes, still, this is preferred when you can have both very strong and very weak signal. This is called a dynamic range. Dynamic range of the signal, yes. And if this dynamic range is wide enough, then it's better to use non-uniform quantizer. For example, this is for digital phone, digital telephone, yes. We are talking about cable phone, not mobile phones, where you can talk loudly or quietly, yes, and well, the system needs to work with your voice in either way, yes. So in all cases, it must send as precisely as possible your voice data. So this is how it's working in yes, in quantizer. So non-uniform quantizer can be beneficial in some tasks. In other tasks, it's not really that important, and we can use the uniform quantizer. Most often we use uniform quantizer because naturally it's easier. However, please don't think that non-uniform quantizer is something difficult. What we actually do with non-uniform quantizer is first we make uniform quantizer. Then we have some logarithmic function, log, multiplied with this, and as a result we get this non-uniform. And accordingly, the stepper will be this logarithmical function. The greater difference will be between maximum and minimum step. Yes, so basically this logarithmical function can actually describe the measure of this non-uniformity. Yes, we can make almost uniform, or we can make very non-uniform quantizer based on choosing this logarithmical function. If you'd like more details, I believe it has been mentioned here, yes. So no, not here. I have definitely seen it somewhere. Advantages for linear pulse. So yes, as for PCM, there can also be multiple types. Here we also have uniform quantizing, and somewhere here was mentioned non-uniform as well. Well, at any rate, I can tell you that you need to look for mu law if you'd like more information, or A law codex. Not codex, they are called companders. Compander device. So, for example, let us look for a low compander. This has some formula. Oh, here is Wikipedia. Yes. Yes, some formula. And you can see a logarithm, natural logarithm in this case, and parameter A. So this parameter A describes how compounding is working. So if we have no compounding, yes, this function is linear, and this linear function is therefore multiplied with, well, no good picture here. Maybe mu law have this picture, no. And here definitely we'll have this picture. No. Okay. Anyway. Low compression. Yes, maybe here. This function is this, yes, this function, no, not this, this is expander, which reverses the effect. So basically this function is then, where was that? Multiplied with this. So you multiply this function with this function, and as a result, you get this function. Yes, so basically all the things you need to do is actually at the beginning multiply your signal with this logarithmical function, yes, then perform uniform quantization, and then accordingly to reverse the effect, you do the same operations and vice versa. So this is very similar to decibel, yes? As you remember, I have shown you that we can have, now, wait a minute, we can have one point here, one point here, one point here, one point here, which is this, for example, 1000, this, for example, will be 1, this, for example, will be 0.01, and this, for example, will be 0.0001, yes? And in order to see them in, to be able to distinguish these three points, we need to use logarithmical scale, yes? In that case, in logarithmical scale, these points will be accordingly possible to be distinguished at the different logarithmical levels. So this is basically the same. So this is logarithm of this function, yes? Basically, well, as you have seen in formulas, it's not really logarithm, yes, it's some ratio with different logarithms, and for mu law we have this formula and parameter is mu, and for a law we have this parameter, which is accordingly another formula. So basically the difference is that mu law is used in North America and a law is used in Europe, yes, but they produce the very same results, yes, with different parameters, because a parameter can be in range of from 1 to 100 and mu parameter can be an integer number from 0 to 2.55. So a parameter, for example, can be 87.6, yes. But okay, I'm a little bit diverting from our topic, yes. Let us finish our lecture part with modulated noise-like signals. So this is another topic when we use as a carrier noise. It's also possible to use a noise to carry your information, yes? Now, it's not really that white noise which we are using in our practical exercise, but it's still a sequence of random numbers, yes? So basically this is a random process and it's used in interesting ways, yes, let us say so. Why do we need to, first of all, use noise as a carrier? This can give us some unexpected benefits. Mainly, the main benefit is that such signals are much more protected from jamming, intentional reducing of your signal. So also the effect of such transmission is achieved by using specific codes. Yes, so we have some code word, and unless you know this code word, you will not be able to receive this signal. So basically, to receive the signal, you must know this code word. This is some sort of a password, yes? If you don't know this code word, then you will see this signal as a noise. For you, this will be a noise. However, for the receiver, knowing this code word, the data can be received correctly and it will provide the information contained in this signal. So this is something like hiding the information from other eyes. It's no cryptographical algorithm, it's not just as strong. Still, this is nice, yes, because what's happening with the spectrum? So consider here we have blue color, the spectrum of our original signal. For example, rectangular pulses sequence, yes, this is the spectrum width. Now, this purple colored signal is noisy signal, noise modulated signal. So here you can see the signal itself. Yes, so this is the signal we are going to transmit. This is our data which we want to transmit, and this data has this spectrum. This is our carrier, which is random sequence of the rectangular pulses, yes, or pseudo-random. What we do is very similarly, we mix together, multiply data signal with carrier and get this transmitted signal, which has this spectrum. The idea here is that the energy which was previously concentrated in this spectrum is now distributed more evenly in this band. Yes, so basically the energy of these signals is the same. However, this energy is focused into this frequency band. And for the noise modulated signal, this energy is focused into this band. Yes, and imagine on top of that, that here is the noise level. And actually, it's impossible to know that anything is transmitting at all if you don't know the code. So you can transmit data secretly, yes, without alerting to the presence of the transmission by using this technique. And well, this is another use for. And third use, as I mentioned, is intentional jamming of the signal. So consider that now we have some radio station making some interference for your signal at this frequency. So here we have not successfully chosen color. So here we have some radio station making some intentional interference to your signal. This way, it completely blocks all your spectrum, yes, if we don't use this noise carrier signal. Now, if we use noise carrier signal, then there is no way this radio station can block your signal everywhere, yes? So basically, if it tries to do that, it will also have to distribute its energy evenly in this band. So the effect of such jamming will be much less in either way, because it's much more difficult to jam wide band rather than narrow band. And this is how we can make communications, well, which are able to work with intentional jamming, intentional interference, yes, that word. So they are more robust communications. Here again, you can see more technical details. However, these will be given to you into other courses, basically, which are related to CDMA communications, yes, and so forth and so on, and spread spectrum techniques. This is more advanced material from next courses you are going to have. Still, in this course, I'd like to mention that this is actually also a type of modulation, yes. And here is, as I have mentioned, the possibility of sending our signal secretly beneath the noise level. And you may ask that if we have a noise level here, wouldn't it be impossible to find this signal in this noise? Again, when we are receiving this signal, we will use the same code to compress our spectrum back into this spectrum. And therefore, it will be possible to receive it. We don't, disobey any law of nature by doing this. We actually have this energy, the very same energy, yes, of the useful signal as before. And as you know, signal to noise ratio is actually, well, basically energy of bit divided by noise spectral density. So our energy of bit is the same. Noise spectral density didn't change either. So the noise immunity of these two cases is actually the same, yes, from the perspective of the white additive Gaussian noise. From the perspective of intentional artificial jamming, the second variant with spread spectrum is better. Yes. So to conclude, yes, we can transmit undetected. We are immune to radio frequency jamming, and also we can make it possible for more users to use the same channel at the same time with less interference. So this is how actually third generation mobile networks worked. Yes, 3G, like CDMA coding and so forth and so on. However, there are also problems. Yes, we use quite wide spectrum, and this is difficult to work with such equipment to to produce such hardware, to design such receivers and so forth and so on, which needs to have some knowledge and care. And also, as usual, we can have synchronization problems because we hardly rely on the code, specific code combination. Yes, it's necessary to apply this code combination at the exact required time moment. If we do this too early or too late, then we will not be able to receive our data. So we need to use this code word at the exact specific moment. And well, we need to know when we need to use this. And this is the problem, yes, that needs some additional solution. Well, there are solutions, of course, as you understand, since we already use this technology in third generation networks, but it's technically, demanding, yes, and asking. So this would be all the material for our lecture today. So if you have any questions, you are welcome to ask them. And now we are going to make another break. I believe we can make also break of 15 minutes and continue at 10:55. And Tianhua Chen will guide you through the second practical exercise. So he will start at this time. Please don't be late if you want to follow up in the process and do this task for yourself. And we'll see you in 15 minutes. Thank you.